ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Sam Roberts Wrestling Podcast. Introducing your host from New York, here is Sam Roberts.
And let's welcome into the studio. There is still, you know, you always wonder. I've interviewed a lot of wrestlers, and I feel like there is still a few that have a vibe of intimidation about them. Jay Briscoe is here. What's up, man?
How you doing? Hey, what's going on, man? Appreciate you having me.
Of course. Anytime. You strike me as the real deal. You know what I mean? Like, just as soon as I meet you, you come across to me like you could hurt somebody.
Well, I mean, thanks.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that's what you want as a wrestler. So, when you were, is wrestling something you always wanted to do growing up? When you were growing up, were you a kid who liked to fight and you realized you could make some money doing it this way?
Well, me and my brother always fought. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, growing up, you know, having a brother not even a year younger than you and our dad, I remember he used to like make us box. I think. I don't know if he was just trying to get us ready or what. But
he made
I mean, he really didn't make us, but I mean, he would give us boxing gloves and kind of, you know, encourage it a little bit. But
instill kind of competition.
Yeah.
One of you's going to win and one of you's going to lose.
Right, yeah.
And that's what it's going to be.
Yep, or playing football, you know, whatever it was, he kind of, he kind of just brought us up like that. But
yeah. Where'd you grow up?
Delaware.
So when you enter into, is that how a lot of people around you were raised? Because I would imagine that when you're raised like that and then you run into somebody like, I don't know, me, Sam Roberts, who had no kind of competition and quit every athletic venture that he ever took part in, that at least growing up you'd be like, you know.
Yeah, I mean, my dad's, you know, he's a pretty tough guy, man. My dad's dad actually played for the Eagles. Played a running back for the Eagles back in the 50s, I guess it was. But Dad, he was real good at football, man. Almost went to the Colts, but ended up getting hurt in a car accident. And he was just, you know, always real competitive and everything. And I mean, there's really not too much to do in Delaware, man.
It's rather a fight.
Just go out there and mess around.
Just learn how to do it. So, did you want to go into football originally?
No, I mean, I always played football, but. I mean, we always liked wrestling, you know. And then, I mean, once ECW came around and we got our first taste of that, then it was kind of.
Yeah. I think that changed it for a lot of people you know, especially because that was like, you know, 94, 95 when it was like Doink the Clown and Isaac Yankem and all this stuff. And then all of a sudden you're like, no, but this is real, though. This is real shit.
Yep. It was, I remember. Heat Wave 99, I think it was, was the first pay-per-view that we watched, man. And I just remember, you know, Shane Douglas starting it off, you know, cut the fucking music.
just an F-bomb being dropped. It was enough, right? What?
Yeah, it was so, you know, just captured us, man. And the first time we saw it, we had a youth basketball tournament up in Philly, in Philadelphia. And we were like 7th, 8th grade or whatever. And you know, we were all hanging out in the hotel room after the game, and we just turned the TV on, and there it was. And, I mean, we were just hooked, you know, from the first time we saw it.
So when did you start? When did you get in the ring? Did you get in the ring pretty quick after that, or at least start a backyard thing?
Oh, yeah. We did a lot of backyard, man.
First of all, when you're growing up in Delaware, and you're trained as a kid to just box with your brother, I'm assuming that you're like, well, I could just set up a ring and do this.
We got so many tapes. Like, we recorded everything we did, you know. It'd just be me versus Mark. And we had a little boom box that we would play the music, you know, and
you had a flair for production value.
And then so it started on a trampoline, and then we ended up our trampoline fell apart, and so we used the frame of the trampoline for a ring that we built, like a little homemade ring. Used the frame and then took like a bunch of boards and kind of put it on top of the trampoline frame. Got some tires, put it underneath, you know, the boards, and then took some garden hose, man, and we had a little makeshift ring out there.
So. And how long did you do that for?
We did that till, this whole time, like, once we were trying to get into schools everywhere, but we were 15 and 16 at the time doing that. And nobody would take you, you know, unless you were 18. And finally, finally we met up with Jim Kettner in Wilmington, who ran ECWA, and we showed him the tape of us backyard wrestling, actually, because at first he was like, y'all are too young. But then we showed him this tape. He's like, well, if they're
You made
already,
yourself a reel.
Yeah, he said, if they're already, you know, doing this much, then. So he took us on, man. And
bring him in.
Yeah, Glenn Osborne was the head trainer. And, we started in 2000, so.
So what kind of, at that time, how were backyard wrestlers looked at? A lot more people were doing it back then. Like, yeah. This is the difference between, like, growing up in the suburbs of New York when your dad worked in advertising versus growing up in Delaware where you come from athletics.
Right.
Like, I wanted to start a backyard league in my backyard.
Yeah, yeah.
But my dad immediately was like, no, the minute a kid gets hurt, we're sued. It's not happening. Yeah. And all this real life started clouding me.
Yeah, we really didn't have, like, a... It was mainly just me and Mark who did it, you know, but then we had two buddies.
We're not going to sue each other.
Yeah. We had two buddies who used to come over and hop in there with us. Well, pretty much like all our friends like would just mess around, but there was two of them that had like names in the league and everything. You know, they were
And so back then when you're starting to train pro wrestling, was backyard wrestling just kind of a natural first step, or was it sort of like, oh, these are backyarders? We don't know.
As far as amongst like the guys training, well, I mean, they, I don't know, man. Because we could kind of like, we didn't know what the hell we were doing, but we were, you know, willing to try, you know, we were willing to do whatever. I mean, I remember I couldn't even. Like, the whole time we were backyard wrestling in this hard-ass ring and falling, like, I remember getting up there and them showing us how to properly bump, and I was just knocking myself loopy every time because I was just used to, I didn't know what the hell I was doing. Uh-huh. And, you know, they worked with us, man. There was, you know, a lot of guys in there who took their time and took care of us and everything.
Figured out how to do it. So yeah. I always wonder because, like, you're from that generation of guys – who are heavily influenced by ECW, and there's like a group of indie guys who you know would have been that next class in ECW. Like when you watch even early tapes of the Briscoe brothers, you know if ECW had been around, this would have been a major force in ECW. When ECW goes out of business, are you sitting there going like, what? What am I going to do now? That was the place. Like,
yeah. I mean, once they went out of business, it switched to Japanese wrestling, you know.
Oh, really?
And and then we got into got real big into All Japan and you know, Kawada and Misawa and matches like that where they were just beating the hell out of you.
And did that happen because of the internet? Because that's a huge leap to go from like, oh yeah, ECW's on our local cable to look what's going on across the world.
Yeah, I mean, between that and, you know, getting tapes and stuff, it was Japanese wrestling was the next kick. So it was it just kind of kept rolling. You
just figure out what the next thing. And then Ring of Honor came around not long after ECW and kind of took over, at least in the beginning, a lot of what that was doing. So you've been, and I want to, did you watch Stone Cold Steve Austin and Vince McMahon do the podcast they did on the WWE Network?
No, I haven't seen it.
Vince McMahon said something that I guess a lot of people are talking about the locker room not being as ambitious anymore. He said something about millennials are just not ambitious people the way that people in the previous generations were. You have now gotten to see kind of a turnover of a generation, kind of, and you're seeing new guys come in now. Do you see that at all? Do you think that the kids coming in now are less ambitious? Are they not as hungry? Are they not as motivated?
I mean, I don't know if it's just like you know, I think it's bigger than just pro wrestling as far as that goes, man. I think like you know, I mean, there's so much cool stuff to do. You know, there weren't no, I mean, we had like regular Nintendo when I was a kid, you know what I mean? And you could only play that for so long before you're like, this is, you know, but now they got all these awesome video games and cell phones and all these gadgets, man. And they, I think like, you know, maybe a lot of them spend maybe a little bit more time than they should doing that kind of stuff rather than, you know, just old-fashioned, get outside and play.
Right. Yeah, like you grow up with Twitter and sort of constant communication with somebody over your phone or the screen or something. You don't actually have to develop socially at all.
Yeah, yeah.
You just get to sit at home. So when did you realize you and your brother, really, that you guys had personalities that were going to translate to, that it wasn't just something. Because, I mean, some of the promos that you guys have done together with the chickens and the everything have been some of the most memorable stuff that's come out of Ring of Honor.
Thanks, man. I don't know. That's a good question. I mean,
and I would imagine you're just being yourself.
Yeah, I mean, everybody, like all the boys in the locker room, when we, you know, when we would tell them that we grew chickens and that we had chicken farm and everything, like they were all so interested, you know, and we would explain the whole process and everything, and we're like, well, you know, if it's if these guys are so into these stories, and maybe we can, you know, make it a little, you know, kind of broaden it out a little bit.
So did you think at first, when people were interested in the chicken farms and everything, are you thinking like, there's nothing interesting about this? This
oh,
is just
man,
life.
Nothing. It's, shoot, I hate them damn chickens, man. They stink. They, I mean, every day it's the same shit, dead chickens. But, I mean, you know, I guess it is what it is.
So you're the, I would imagine you getting in with Mark, that your goal, you're just a couple of kids and your goal was probably always to be a tag team, correct? Mm-hmm. So you're now the Ring of Honor World Champion at the time of this recording. Who knows what happens in the future, but and it's two times for you?
Yeah.
How does Mark react to that?
Well, I mean, I don't know. If it does, you know, bother him or whatever, he really doesn't. You know, I mean, I think he knows what's going on, man. I mean, he still does his thing, and
is that a weird conversation to have to be like, Mark, they just told me they're going to put the belt on me. Like, I don't know what that means for us, but right now,
yeah.
You know, I'm kind of...
You know, but I mean, we still do, like, a lot of tagging and everything, like, through the title reigns, so we still, I mean, we're still together. And, I mean, Mark still does his thing, you know, he's... I mean, we'll always be a tag team, you know. We'll always be what we are. It's just, you know, sometimes you just got to do what you got to do, I guess.
And what's it like for you to start getting a taste of, like, this is what it's like to just have the spotlight to yourself, to not be a part of a team?
It's, I don't know. Like right now, that question right there, if Mark was here, he would have the perfect answer, you know what I mean? Like, that's the thing. Like,
well, yeah, I guess that's the first thing is, you have to get used to the fact that you don't, it's just you.
I got the whole load, you know what I mean? Like, I can't pass it off, you know, and...
Because you've been teaming for how long?
I mean, since our first match.
Right.
And that was May of 2000.
So, like, 15 years, just about.
Yeah.
And now it's only been in the last however many years that we're like, no, the Ring of Honor is going, we're going to try to make you a single star.
Yeah.
And at that point, you're like, that's like 13 years, say.
Well, the one who... The one who it bothers the most is my mother, man. She's not a real big fan of us doing singles.
She doesn't like it.
Oh, man.
Why is that?
I don't know, man.
Because I would imagine your dad must like it, because this is going back to, like,
the old
days of boxing.
He's just waiting for me versus Mark. You know what I mean? He's waiting for that. But, yeah, mom is like...
You don't like it, Mark? Get in the ring with it.
Yeah. Yep. But
your mom doesn't like it.
Nah, she wants, you know, straight tag team. But, I mean, it's... You know, it's all good, man. And speaking of dad, I just got a funny story, man. I remember we were backyard wrestling one time, and I gave Mark a Van Damminator, threw a chair in his face, and ended up breaking his nose. And I just remember he was bleeding.
You're in the backyard and you're just watching Van Damminators on TV. You don't know what you're doing.
Yeah, no, have no clue, man.
Right.
And I remember, so I guess dad was like watching out the kitchen window, and so he saw this, you know, saw it go down, and so he rolls down the window, and starts hollering, "Now break his nose, Mark! Break his nose!" So,
and does Mark then turn around and try to break your nose?
Well, he was bringing it, but I mean, he never broke my nose, but he was bringing it.
He was trying.
Yeah.
When you guys have gotten so much experience, even starting out, just fighting each other, does it make it so that if you're in the, you can kind of handle yourself in the ring against anybody? You know what I mean? Like if something develops in the ring where all of a sudden I'm really in a fight with this dude, well, I've been in 100 fights with Mark. I can handle myself.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, depends on who I'm in there with. I might get my ass whooped, you know. But
Is that the trick to being able to fight, is not being petrified of getting your ass whooped?
Maybe so.
It feels like once you're not scared of that, you can probably win a lot more fights. Like, I think I'd be so worried about getting my ass kicked that I wouldn't even be focused on winning anything, and I'd get my ass kicked.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it happens, you know. You know.
Makes you stronger as a person,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. So, have you? What has it been like holding the title and being, like, the guy? Like, Ring of Honor is like, no, you're a guy. You're our representative. You're going to go out and do interviews. You're going to go and do this. Like, is that something you're comfortable with? Were you comfortable with it right away?
I mean, I'm still not, man. I mean, you know, I'm over here shaking in my boots.
Yeah.
But no, man, I mean, it's, you know, it's just something, it just kind of, I don't know, man, just go with the flow, you know?
And that's it. You're like, all right, I mean, if you're going to, main event is better than anything else. So if you're going to put me in the main event, I'll do it.
Yes, sir. I mean, it's just roll with it, man.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you, so what's your, do you have a goal right now? Is there like a place that you want to get to? Because like you said, you start, you're like, I want to get to ECW. ECW goes out of business, you want to get to Japan. I'm assuming you wanted to get to Ring of Honor. You get to Ring of Honor. You've been to Japan. You've now won the World Heavyweight title twice, which in Ring of Honor is a big deal. You know, in other organizations, the title kind of gets passed around, but that doesn't really happen in Ring of Honor. Is there a next thing that you want to like achieve or accomplish?
I mean, we ain't been to New Japan yet, and you know, we got this relationship starting up with them and everything.
Yeah,
and,
that surprises me that you haven't done anything with New Japan.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's been some mumblings. It's been some. So hopefully, man, you know, if everything works out, it'll be.
That's the next thing.
I mean, that's, and I mean, of course, you know, just to keep. You know, just do what we got to do to make Ring of Honor, you know, hopefully as big as it can get, man.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I mean, that's always the main goal, man.
Is there a preference to you between working heel or babyface?
Because
right now, I mean, because you've figured out a way to kind of get into both. Like, you're the common man if you're a good guy, but, like, when you were in Jersey All Pro, believed you as a racist member of the Hillbilly Wrecking Crew. You know what I mean? Like, I believed you. You didn't like Puerto Ricans. I believed it.
Yeah, man. It's, I mean, it just, you know, whatever it's called for, but,
You're ready to do it.
Yeah. It's, I mean, both of them got their advantages, disadvantages, but whatever, you know, needs to happen.
Was there a point, or is there a point now? Is WWE something you look at as, something you would consider in the future? Have you gotten close to getting there? Because I feel like the Briscoes are one of those teams that everybody, like, why not even a kind of moment in the WWE? You would think at some point along the way.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's been, you know, we've been talking with them in the past and stuff, you know, we've, I mean, I don't know, man. We kind of got a lot of stuff going on at home, you know, I mean, I could just imagine my wife, you know, the schedule those guys got.
Yeah.
You know, my wife home with three kids, Mark's wife home with three kids. But, I mean, I'm never going to say never, but, I mean, I don't know. It's just.
And you seem to have found a pretty good niche for yourself. Like, you found a place that you fit, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I also wonder, like, if figuring out a way to stay independent in pro wrestling isn't the secret to happiness in that world. Like, are you still happy to be in the business?
Oh, man, I love it.
Yeah, do you think that part of that would be because you're kind of
that's a good question.
Doing your own thing?
That's a, I don't know, man. I mean, maybe still, you know, I never really thought of it like that, but, I mean, I've never had it, you know, I just have this, you know, I've never had it there or anything, but, I mean, I don't know, man. Just kind of go with the flow.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. You're going with it. I mean, it serves you well so far. Are you, it seems like, I mean, you have, at the pay-per-view coming up, you have a match without honor, which is the hardcore style, in the sense that it's no holds barred.
Right.
But it seems like there's a lot less hardcore wrestling now than there was, like, say, 10 years ago.
Right.
Are you happy about that, just in terms of your own health?
Well, I mean...
Or do you enjoy...
Sometimes it's called for. Like, I think Sunday night, it's going to get pretty pretty crazy.
Pretty brutal.
There. Yeah.
Yeah.
So kind of bring it back a little bit.
You don't mind it. But do you like that now it's more of an attraction than, you know, years ago when it was sort of like, this is what we do every night?
Right. Yeah. I mean, it was starting to get to the point where it was getting overdone a little bit.
Yeah.
And, but yeah, I mean, now... Yeah. I mean, Mark, he's the main one who is a, as far as hardcore wrestling goes, like, he was born for that, man.
He loves it.
Like, jumping off of whatever, I mean, he was, yeah, like, he was born for that shit, man.
Yeah. And some of the shit that you see you guys do early on are those quintessential things, like, well, yeah, well, these guys aren't going to be around much longer.
Right,
that's the way.
Yeah.
And you guys have been around.
Yeah,
like,
and that, man, that was something, like, yeah, like, we definitely had to learn how to tone it back a little bit. Cause,
well, at what point were you like, okay, that's, we can't be doing this every night?
That's a good question, man. I guess when I was, like, probably only 20 years old and I was feeling like I was 80, you know.
Right, and, it just all caught up in a
heartbeat. But
what are when you're wrestling hardcore style, what are the more brutal isn't the word, but the things that you do to each other that really affect your bodies that you don't even realize? Like, I'm assuming, yeah, like a staple gun hurts in the moment,
right,
but doesn't have long term damage.
I don't know. I don't know if chair shot to the head.
Is that one of those things that, like, people, because they used to see it so much, don't realize that?
Yeah,
it's horrible. It's steel smashing against your skull.
Yeah, but I mean, I really don't mind them. You know, really.
You don't.
I mean, I don't know. Falling, like, falling on the floor is because I remember, like, I mean, we used to do stuff like from the apron to the floor, mm-hmm, or, like, from the top rope to the floor. Like, that's when you're doing stuff like that, man. I mean, you really jam yourself up. And for me, I know, and this isn't even like a hardcore type thing, but I used to do a top rope leg drop, and man, that, I mean, I feel that every damn day. That damn.
I talked to Hulk Hogan, of all people, and I said, mm-hmm, like, what's your regret? Like, looking back on the career, you got to have one regret. And he's like, yeah, the regret is that I made the leg drop my finish.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
it kills, man, you. It just sends it, what is it? It sent a shockwave up your spine.
Yeah, it just compresses you.
How long?
I remember.
You, yeah, go ahead.
Like, the first time I really started doing it was in Big Japan, our first ever tour of Japan, mm-hmm, which was 2001 in Big Japan Pro Wrestling. And, you know, I was like, man, we're in Japan, we got to do it up. And so I was just dropping it like every match of the tour. and back then it didn't really bother me too much. And, damn if it didn't catch up with me now. I mean,
right. So if we see one of those like today, we know that killed you just then.
Yeah,
like,
yep.
that was bad.
The last one I did was in Toronto, Canada, and I can't remember what show it was, but I remember I did it to Jimmy Jacobs, and I knew as soon as I hit it, like, I'm never doing this move again.
Yeah,
like, it just took everything out of me, man.
You saying Jimmy Jacobs reminded me of that whole kind of Ring of Honor class. Do you watch, or are you just aware of what's going on over in WWE and seeing, you know, Daniel Bryan and seeing, I mean, not Punk anymore, but Punk for a long time, and mm-hmm, seeing, you know, Samoa Joe killing it in TNA, and seeing Claudio, and seeing Seth Rollins, and seeing all these guys that, like, you were part of, like, Generico, and, mm-hmm, and now Steen's over there and all this stuff. And everybody is super successful over there. Does that, what type of effect does that have on you?
I'm glad to see it, man.
Yeah.
You know, it's, I mean, I'm watching my friends go out there and wrestle on TV, you know, Monday Night Raw or whatever it is. But it's cool, man, because, like, you know, just say if, like, Claudio Cesaro has a match,
yeah,
or whatever, and then, like, my son, he's 5 now. I was like, you know, I'll pull out an old DVD and show, you know, me versus Claudio or something and show it to him, and, you know, he gets a kick out of that.
Yeah,
man,
he does.
So, yeah.
And does he sit there watching, like, that's what Cesaro's capable of? Yeah. Like, that's what that dude can do?
Yeah, and it's funny, man. Like, he usually always roots for me, you know. He likes his daddy, but whenever I'm wrestling, like, Claudio, you know, Seth Rollins, Daniel, anybody like that, them old DVDs, he always wants them to win, man, for whatever reason.
Well, because he knows them from TV. He's probably got their toys.
Yeah, like, yeah.
But you guys are getting toys, right?
Yeah.
Did I just hear the Ring of Honor is
getting toys, baby?
A toy,
yep,
deal?
Now all we need is a video game, and we good.
And you're good. Yeah. So have you seen any sort of prototypes or anything,
yeah,
of what your action
I've
figure
seen,
looks
like? I've seen the head.
Wow.
And at first, man, they had me all blowed up. I was like, man, they got to do something about this. But, yeah, now they got it looking pretty good.
Really, it looked too round at first?
Like. Yeah, it was like just a big round head. Like, I looked fat as shit. And I was like, man, I don't look like, You know, but now they got it. They got it looking pretty good.
That's pretty crazy. So what's your wrestling schedule like right now? Like how often are you working?
I mean, pretty much just whenever Ring of Honor has a show.
That's it?
Yeah.
And do you do other stuff in the meantime?
Well, we do. Like, we can do overseas stuff. Like, we just got back from England this past weekend. We had, you know, four shows over there. And, you know, hopefully this thing with New Japan, you know, comes forth. But
do you not do other indie promotions out of your choice or because that's what Ring of Honor prefers?
Well, I mean, kind of a little bit of both.
Yeah, like Ring of Honor prefer it, but you get it.
Yeah, yeah, oh yeah.
You make it a special thing to see Jay Briscoe.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Well, and obviously you love that schedule.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I mean, and I guess that's also, that's why Ring of Honor can wrestle a style that they wrestle, because you couldn't do Ring of Honor shows 5 nights a week.
Beat the shit out of each
every
other.
Every week, yeah. Because you look at it's hard. It's hardcore in the sense of it's
the physicality of it. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, it's a really interesting style because you don't need weapons most of the time. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like I went to a Ring of Honor show years ago, and I brought my wife, and she didn't even like wrestling. Mm. Like she's sick of it by now because she's had it around her too much. But she'll like, you know, the fireworks over here, the music over here, the silly outfit over here, or whatever. But it was the first time at a Ring of Honor show I took her, and she goes, "Oh, I really like that match."
Yeah.
I think it was Brian versus Nigel McGuinness.
Okay, yeah.
And she was like watching. She was like, "I like," and I was like, "You liked the match."
Yeah.
And she was like, "Yeah," and it was the rest of the show. And now she's like, she knows who the Briscoes are. She knows who, like, cool. She knows all this sort of inside stuff. Well, listen, good. And do you like being the champion? Do you want to?
Damn,
hold
man.
It forever? Do you
I
wanna...
mean, I hold it as long as I need to hold it.
Once you're done with it, you're done with it.
Yeah.
So right now, you're go with the flow until whatever. New Japan is hopefully in the future, and as far as anything else goes, you're just going to see what happens.
Yes, sir.
That's beautiful. That's a good way to live life. Well, listen. Whenever you find yourself a Jay Briscoe toy,
oh yeah,
make sure
should be coming soon, man.
Make sure you pick it up. And you think there's going to be a video game?
I don't know.
It could
never
be.
Say
right?
never,
I mean, I guess you probably wouldn't have thought there were action figures
right,
a year
ago,
right?
Yeah.
So, awesome, awesome. Well, thanks for hanging out, man.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me.
And good luck with everything.
Yes, sir. Appreciate it.